harbinger of justice who spoke into his culture at a time when the people forgot. Hear what the scriptures say. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and your enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? And what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, what Balaam son of Beor answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before God with burnt offerings and calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He's told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? Our second scripture is a familiar scripture. It's from the Beatitudes. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying,
Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted.
Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth.
Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled.
Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy.
Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God.
Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God.
Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you.
Amen.
Amen. And blessed are the children, as we bless them and pray for them as they leave for church school with Deborah.
Please be seated. A week and a day ago, I woke up before dawn at my house in Alexandria, Virginia. I had looked up the schedule for the metro in advance, planning to meet with my friends on the National Mall at 9:30 in the morning for the Women's March. Because I live in Washington, D.C., I know that the metro could be tricky, and so I got there at 7:40 in the morning for a 9:30 appointment for a metro ride that was 23 minutes away. When we arrived at the station, I was stunned. My husband dropped me off. There were 8 buses, and when I walked up to the gates, there was this crowd of women all wearing pink, and their hats all looked exactly like mine. I started talking to them, and I discovered that they were 8 buses full of women who had come up from North Carolina, mostly people who lived in Chapel Hill or Durham or Raleigh, and they were there full of energy and joy to march. We got on the metro. I'd never seen so many people in the metro in my entire life. And I got off at the stop for the National Mall, for the appointed place to meet my friends was at the American Indian Museum on the patio in front of the museum. And I looked at the crowds and I thought, ooh, it's good I'm here first. I'll save us a place. I started walking down Independence Mall and Avenue, and before I could get very far, the road was already filled with people from every direction. I knew the cut through, since I was a local, so I went behind the museum, around the reflecting pool, which has been designed in such a beautiful way at the Indian Museum. It's not a standard sort of square reflecting pool. It's a natural one with organic edges. And around the edges, there are these rock features, these beautiful rocks, that is all meant to sort of imitate a kind of Western landscape with a river flowing through it. I made my way around to the front, and there were already crowds of people. Evidently, we were not the only group who decided to meet in front of the museum. For there was a whole group of women dressed in native garb, holding hands and signs, and they were dancing, and they were saying, "Standing Rock, Standing Rock, Standing Rock." And there was drummers, and there was smudging, and the incense smell was beginning to make clouds on the patio. One of the women in Cherokee outfit reached out when she saw that I was there all by myself. And she literally just said, "Dance with me." And she pulled me into the circle, and I danced with the native women, and we chanted about water. And then we were finished. I looked around and I thought, where should I stand? Because my friends aren't here yet. And I made my way over to some rocks, and there was a kind of a bench in front of the rocks. And so I stood up on the bench in front of the rocks, and I waited with my little pink hat after dancing with the Cherokee for about an hour by myself. And finally, I saw someone from my group. I was so excited. I started waving, and I knew where they were my group because they were all wearing collars. I was meeting a whole group of clergy women and a couple other writers. And they were thrilled to find me because the crowds were growing so thick. They had the signs. Oh, just not my hat. Now I finally had a sign. And my friend, Cameron, she said, "Here they are, here we are, here are all the signs. Take a sign, take a sign, take a sign." And the signs were, "Blessed are the poor. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the uninsured. Blessed are the activists. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the immigrants. Blessed are the indigenous. Blessed are the persecuted. Blessed are the LGBTQ. And the crowd grew thicker, and we're standing there with our signs. And someone in our group finally said, "Let's go stand on the rocks." And so we climbed up these rocks. It was kind of a foggy morning, and the rocks were a little slippery. And it was a little fearsome. But we got to the top of the rocks, and we held up our signs, the Beatitudes, the ones written in Matthew, and the ones that we wrote ourselves. And as we held the signs up, not only was the water flowing like a river by us, but all of a sudden the crowds were flowing. Huge numbers of mostly women, but men of every race you can possibly imagine, all ages from infants to great-grandmothers. And then the most astonishing thing began to happen. People from the crowd looked up to the rocks and started cheering the Beatitudes. "Yeah, blessed are the peacemakers! Impeach Trump!" It was amazing. And so they started cheering the Beatitudes and throwing in all these interesting other slogans, and they waved their signs back to us. And then people stopped. Seeing my friends, I'm not a clergy person, but they saw all my friends with collars, and they stopped. And they said, "The church is here?"
Would you pray for me? Can I pray with you? And we pray. Some of us there on the rocks, kneeling down, holding the hands of people who were walking by. The crowd cheering the Beatitudes and waving their own signs in response. And then we began to notice that we weren't the only ones with Bible verses on our signs. I was a stranger and you welcomed me, walked by. God is love. Do justice. Love kindness. And yes, people kept cheering the Beatitudes. And as we listened to the cheers and we held up our signs, someone walked by with a huge icon. And the icon was Janet McKenzie's painting, Jesus of the People. Janet McKenzie's very famous painting, Jesus of the People, was commissioned in 1999 by the Roman Catholic Church as an icon for the new millennium. Of this amazing icon, where Jesus is depicted as a person, you can't really tell if Jesus is a he or Jesus is she, but Jesus has very dark skin. Jesus is not white, it's not European. The National Catholic Reporter said this of the icon: it is a haunting image of the peasant Jesus, dark, thick-lipped, looking out on us with ineffable dignity. Jesus of the people went by where we were holding up the Beatitudes. I don't think I ever understood the Beatitudes until that moment. 2,000 years ago, Jesus stood on some rocks on a hillside. Blessed are the poor. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the persecuted. Blessed, he said, are all you outcasts, all you who feel like you have no voice, all you who feel as if everything is being taken from you, all you who feel that the world is collapsing. Blessed are you, victims of the empire. You are blessed. You are the ones that God favors. And can you imagine the crowds walking by that hillside that day? No wonder they stopped to listen. These words, as human history flowed by the base of that mountain, these words shone forth unlike any other words they had ever heard. God is not with the people who live in palaces. God's blessing is not with those who hold power. God blesses those whom the empire despises, whom the empire silences, who the empire jails, who the empire executes and exiles and sends to the edges of existence and ignores their deepest humanity. The Beatitudes were not some nice little sermon that Jesus decided to preach on a hillside on a sunny day. Here are the politics of Jesus. The politics of love. Standing on those rocks, defending the marginalized, the oppressed, people who are afraid, the victims of the powerful,
Blessed are the poor. While I was there, Jesus came into my view in a whole new way. And I heard those Beatitudes so powerfully in my own mind. A text arrived on my phone. I pulled it out of my pocket. It was from my husband. And he said, "There are a lot of people protesting in other cities around the country, but you've all just been knocked off of CNN. Instead, they're showing the service, the prayer service at the National Cathedral. They just sang, 'God Bless America.'" And I looked at the text, and some of you might know, but if you're not Episcopalians, you might not know. For the weeks previous to the National Cathedral prayer service, this particular inaugural prayer service, I had been writing letters, agitating, and organizing Episcopalians all across the country and the city of Washington, D.C., to beg the National Cathedral to forgo this particular service. I worried, not that I don't believe in praying for people, but I worried that the powerful would somehow use the cathedral, use that beautiful church as a stage set where it would become deeply politicized in a way that was counter to the very things that the Episcopal Church had taught me over my 30 years as an Episcopalian. We raised a bit of a ruckus, but we were ignored. Those of us who asked the cathedral in our very nice and polite Episcopal way not to have service were told that this was a tradition and that we Episcopalians always stand with tradition. I did point out to them that in 1973 the cathedral had hosted the counter-inaugural of Richard Nixon, but that was not a tradition they wanted to embrace. And so there we were, me and my friends standing on the rocks with the Beatitudes, and across Washington, D.C., on another hill, Mount St. Albans, the National Cathedral. Two different visions of church. There's a book that's written about the beginnings of the National Cathedral, about why that church was built there and what it's all about 100 years ago. And the book is called The Power of Their Glory, America's Ruling Class, the Episcopalians. This is my tradition. But I have always loved that glorious building, and I have been an Episcopalian for a really long time. But I, myself, over the last few years, was having a bit of a struggle with that. The power of our glory, of being a church of the ruling class. Indeed, about 4 years before this particular day last week, I had walked into the National Cathedral after returning from a trip to Du Bois, Wyoming, where I had been hiking for a week in the Wind River Range. And I was struggling with some work and writing that I had to do, and I needed to pray. And so I went and I sat down in this beautiful chapel in the National Cathedral with this huge altarpiece surrounded by angels in glory. There's a great, great picture of Jesus with his arms stretched out. All these cherubim praising Jesus. And I knelt before that Jesus and I said, "Jesus, I can't hear your voice. Help me hear where I need to go. Help me know who you really are." And I looked up to Jesus in glory, and I heard a voice. And Jesus spoke to me, saying, get me out of here. I said, what did you say, Jesus? I said, get me out of here. And I went, okay. And I left the building. The Jesus of glory, or the Jesus of the people? The gospel is, surprisingly, always about politics. It's not about partisanship. It's not about what party you belong to, or winning, or saying I'm right and you're wrong. But politics, the life of the city, the polis. Our whole striving is towards a different city, the New Jerusalem, the city of God that descends, in which we live with God forever, where a river flows out of the very heart of God through the whole of the world, watering the planet with trees and forests and gardens growing on each side, where there are people from every tongue and tribe and nation who gather there in community together. And that is political. My cell phone kept sending texts to me. My husband said, they didn't read the Beatitudes up at the cathedral. I said, what did they read? He said, they read a passage from Kings. About Solomon arrayed in wisdom. He said, oh, and by the way, they sang, how great thou art. And then my husband, who has never been known for anything other than snark, said, I'm not sure who the hymn was directed to. And so I was getting the running Richard Bass commentary of the prayer service while holding up my sign with one hand and doing this with my cell phone, blessed are the poor. And finally, a different text popped on the phone, my 19-year-old daughter. And she texted, I tried to see you in the march, but they knocked you off by CNN, at CNN. So I'm watching the prayer service from the National Cathedral, my daughter who practically grew up in the National Cathedral, because I was on sort of a position called a senior scholar at the National Cathedral for about 8 years. I loved that place. I loved it. I know every nook and cranny of it. And when my daughter was little, she used to go there with me. And one of the most incredible spiritual experiences of her entire life was listening to Barbara Brown Taylor preach in that cathedral. It brought tears to her 9-year-old eyes, and she said that she was so proud of her church, that she understood the gospel because of the words of that woman in that place at that time. But this morning she texted me and she said, this looks really bad for the National Cathedral and the Episcopalian Church. And then I won't tell you the next text because that's her business. But her next text was not good news for a church that hopes to attract millennials or keep the people who they had baptized. And I thought of Jesus, the Jesus of glory trapped on the other hill. Get me out of here. It really isn't a choice anymore, and it never really has been. For 2,000 years, Jesus has been standing on the rocks, crying out to all of us. Everything you think about power is wrong.
and real power, God's favor, is with all of those who are despised by the world. Jesus of the people. And we just kept marching. Amen.